Oh man, I almost feel like that announcer from the 1960s Batman series. We left you with a heck of a cliffhanger last week with Mike saying, oh, I've got this great new product that's coming out and we can't wait to tell you about it. Well, we're going to today. Gonna find out what Mike Sokol from RV Electricity has been towing around with what and more. And it's all about the future of towable RVs and electric vehicles. So let's go with Mike Sokol from RV Electricity.
Okay, well, what I do have is Rockwood has a GeoPro series line, and they very gracefully agreed to send me one to play with of their brand new version of it that is set up basically as this electric hybrid thing. And what do they call it? The power package, right. And this thing has 600 or 580 watts ish of solar on the roof, which is basically fills the whole roof up. This is a G19 FBTH. So the GeoPro 19 foot front bedroom
toy hauler
version, right. Yeah. But really what makes this cool, it has a 400 amp hour Mastervolt battery, big lithium battery in there. It looks like a car battery, but huge, laid sideways. And it has a 3000 watt hybrid inverter, which is really cool. And it has a 12 volt DC Danfoss compressor. I think it's a Danfoss, but it's certainly a 12 volt DC compressor refrigerator in it. And, you know, conventional, you know, furnace, you know, off of propane, conventional, you know, cooktop and an oven, you know, off of propane. But they've integrated this so well, it'll run the air conditioner. It has a 11.5 KBTU Coleman air conditioner on the roof. It'll run for a solid 4 hours off the battery, four hours.
Which is pretty impressive.
And pretty darn impressive. Really, really cool.
Assuming getting no power from the sun whatsoever.
Right. And you can set it's perfect for mooch docking, which is my new favorite term for the RV business. It's not boondocking where you go out in the boonies. It's mooch docking where you mooch power off of like your brother-in-law by pulling in his driveway. You could plug into the outlet and you can say, I only want this outlet to take 10 amps or 15 amps or whatever it's comfortable doing without tripping. And then whenever your RV needs more power than that, it just takes it from the battery. Whenever it needs less power than that, it puts it back into the battery. And you don't even have to think about it. There's a little adjustment that you can do on their panel that says the maximum amount of current you can do. And I discovered this would be really handy because first thing I did was run the battery all the way down to zero. It wants to charge the battery at like 170 or 180 amperes or something, which pulls like 23 amps, 24 amps from the 120 volt line, which the first thing I did was tripped out my poor little Honda 2200 generator. You can watch, of course, I'm metering everything. I'm watching it 2 amps, 4 amps, 8 amps, 12 amps, 16 amps, 20 amps. And my generators go, oh, boom. So I called my guys up and I said, I remember you said you can set this down. I said, oh yeah, go on the panel, go click, click, click. And I could set it down to say a maximum of 15 amps. So once the battery came up, then the generator just goes back down on idle mode because of, it doesn't need it anymore. You know, it gets on float charge and you can watch on it. It's that 600 watts of solar panels. If you're out in the sun, it takes over for all of that. So it's got an integrated solar controller. I really love a hybrid inverter. Again, is not an either or, you know, either, you know, campground power or your own stuff. It blends the two. It mixes the two together.
Yeah, that is cool. And then you can also add, I believe that charge controller is able to accept a portable panel.
So it does. Yeah, you could run those out. And I've got a couple guys that are sending me a number of portable panels. I think now here's one of the things I always thought, this is the conundrum of solar panels. They're normally mounted on the roof of your RV. So in order to get enough power to really make it successful, you've got to park it in the sun, which makes it hot.
Yeah,
What you would really like to do is park your RV under the trees, and then 30 or 40 feet away or whatever, you would love to put solar panels on the ground. And you have that flexibility with this.
Yeah, which makes a lot of sense. That's what we have been doing when Peggy and I go camping. We have our portable panel because you're right. We park it, the RV, in the shade if possible, and throw the panel out in the sun, and bing, bang, boom. So.
Yep. And when you're driving down the road, it's completely recharging the thing just from the panels on the roof. And so it brings the whole thing up. It does have a 12 volt DC compressor refrigerator. It's not real huge. I don't know, maybe it's 6 cubic feet or something like that. But, you know, real freezer, real refrigerator. But the solar panel is enough to keep it running forever. And, you know, which again is a good thing. I will admit to being a little skeptical. I know that they've been around for decades, but I don't like having a flame make your refrigerator cold. It just feels wrong to me, even though I know all the physics.
Yeah.
I know how all this works. It just seems wrong.
Yeah. It's friends of mine who are firefighters have rolled to a lot of RV fires, and it's just, it doesn't make any logical sense, but you're right. I know the theory. I know how it works, but it's still weird.
Yeah. Well, I do have a couple of 12 volt DC refrigerators here in my shop that I've been testing. One was an 8 cubic foot one from Vitrafrigo. And now I currently have a 10 cubic foot one from Dometic. They draw essentially half the power of a standard 120 volt compressor refrigerator. So I would never put a residential one in one of my RVs. I just wouldn't. These things are so good. Mine out there, even though I have mine sitting in my garage and it's like 98 degrees in my garage, getting hotter than holy heck. I'm still down like 1 degree below zero in the freezer, and I can get the refrigerator down to like 34 degrees, which is where you want to be.
Yeah. And I think it's the time I could talk about this. Boy, I sure hope so, because I'm about to. We saw when we were in Indiana, Furion has a new large double French door 12 volt refrigerator, and Magic Chef already has one. And
right.
I mean, that's what you'd want in any RV. They're beautiful.
I think that it was a bad idea just to start slapping residential refrigerators and modified sine inverters in an RV without considering, you know, all of the things that can go wrong with things like that. And especially a number of the refrigerator manufacturers said they refuse to honor the warranties once they put them in an RV, and an RV technician won't work on it because it's a residential refrigerator, and a residential refrigerator guy won't work on it because it's in an RV. Ah.
And the other part, and we have the most popular episode of this podcast is about RV refrigeration. But we have friends who work at dealerships, and the way to repair these residential refrigerators is pull out the windshield of a motorhome or the slide room of a...
Take the whole slide out. Yeah, take the whole slide out to get the thing out, because they won't fit through the door. And I looked at that and I'm going, okay. Again, you know, I am a student of failure. Remember, this is one of the things. I was always be a troubleshooter on systems. And if I were looking for things to go wrong, that right there is the thing that's going to go wrong, because you don't have any decent way to repair this thing. And if you're in the middle of a camping trip or vacation and your refrigerator goes down, your lifestyle has just changed drastically.
Yeah. You're not going to the appliance store and going, can you fix this? Cause they're going to go, no,
no. They'll say, what? No, but this is my home. I agree. You know, it's your home while you're on the road, but refrigerator manufacturers never really thought of that.
Well, or it's just what you want to buy 500 refrigerators. Okay. We don't care where you're putting them.
But, right.
And it also goes back to RV. A lot of RV decision makers don't go camping. So
I see that as a real issue. I think that people ought to live the life, walk the walk, talk the talk,
right. You know,
and then you understand things real rapidly. This is why I wanted to play with electric vehicles. I mean, I could look at stuff, I could read stuff, I could see what all the marketing guys told me. And I, and you know, to the credit of both Ford and Volkswagen, they sent me stuff and said, go do it.
And there is the perfect segue.
I'm just handing them off to you.
Man, you're awesome. I love this. So not only do we talk about electric travel trailers and the Ford pickup that can charge those, you got to play with an electric vehicle in the realm of towing.
Exactly right. So Volkswagen was brave enough to send me an ID4, and this is their SUV. It's kind of a, not huge, but medium-sized SUV, all electric, 75 kilowatt hour battery, rated for about 275 mile range normally. And it does get a real 275 mile range. Me blasting down the highway at 70, 75 miles an hour. It's pretty amazing. It works really well, but it has a class 2 hitch on it. Now, I've never towed with a class 2 hitch before. So I had to get all the appropriate stuff to do it. And I actually have tried this with two different travel trailers now. I've had a, from our friends up in Canada, they built and sent me one down, the Safari Condo Alto trailer, which is that really cool teardrop trailer with the clamshells up. So it's 6'6" inside when the roof is up. Yeah.
That's a
It's like 4 foot nothing or whatever. When it's down, you can kind of get in it, but I forget what it is exactly, but pretty low enough that it wasn't bad. And you can get it with this is the new option, 400 watts of solar panels on it, 200 amp hours of lithium battery. You can get it optionally with a 12 volt refrigerator. Does still have a propane tank because it's got propane powered furnace, propane powered burners. And I went on a couple of towing experiments with this to just kind of see some mileage things. And in fact, whenever this, I'm just writing up my basics of this in my RV electricity thing that just would have published earlier this week, last Saturday, if this is going out Thursday or whenever this goes out. So a week ago, I'll send you the link.
Okay.
So that you can see this. And I put all my numbers. I did some towing experiments at 55, 60, and 65 miles an hour. The other thing that I did, my good friends here, I got to make sure, extreme outdoors. They loaned me just for a few hours, one of their MyPod XTs. And this is a little 800, 900 pound kind of a thing that looks like all fiberglass egg. But I blasted all around the highway with that thing for a few hours with this ID4. I had people giving me the thumbs up. You know, here's the really interesting thing. It seems like half the people love the fact that they can see, they can hear this is an electric vehicle towing a little travel trailer of some sort. And other half of the people, I had one girl pull down her pink mask, stick her tongue at me and scowl because she could see I had an electric vehicle.
Wow.
I was like, I'm just sitting here getting a charge here. I ain't hurting anybody. I then also took the ID4, the Volkswagen, down to St. Michael's, Maryland here earlier this week with my wife. I said, I need to go on a trip, an extended trip somewhere that they've got Maryland blue crabs so that I could see how my range is. And they also had a number of destination stations, charging stations down there. And that was really cool because, you know, it's 125 mile trip down there. And so that gets a little iffy to go there and back without recharging, but because they had a destination charging stations all over the place, in fact, maybe a dozen of them within walking distance of any of the restaurants, you could plug in, they didn't charge you for electricity, but it charged you like $2 an hour for the spot, as it were. There's a few legal things to get around, but it was like a 7.6 or so kilowatt charger. So it basically added 50 miles of range in the 2 hours that we were bopping around. I was, you know, so my wife goes, this is actually really nice. I mean, it's a gorgeous vehicle, I think. And you know, it's a little hard to get used to at first because it's got they've got automatic lane centering stuff. You can put it into cruise control and lock onto the vehicle speed in front of you. I mean, it's got all of the modern stuff, but it looks like a plain old SUV, so it doesn't, and it kicks butt. I mean, when I'm driving that, when I was driving the Alto around, in fact, I took the Alto this morning over to Frederick, Maryland, but it blasts around. I mean, I hate to say it, but I mean, it pulled that 1800 pound trailer like it was nothing.
And that pretty cool. So it how is the range with pulling that? And what are the
I'll give you all the numbers if you go look on the site, but any of these things, if you have a significant size RV, which this is compared to the size of this thing, you can lose 40 or 50% of your range right off top. It's just that's unfortunate, but that's what happens. But with the little MyPod XT, it was more like 20-25%. Of it, because it's within within the actual envelope of the tow vehicle itself. This is not about weight. This is really about wind,
right?
Wind resistance.
The bigger the box you have to shove through the wind, the more power it takes.
Right. But interestingly, the hills really didn't seem to affect it, because as you're going up a hill, you could see it. And it's a very, very comprehensive panel. You could see it using more kilowatt hours per mile to go, as it were. But when you're coming down, it's actually putting the electricity back into the battery. So instead of heating up brakes, or it almost acts like an engine brake. It acts like a Jake brake, but I need a fancy name for that, you know, but it's regenerative braking. That doesn't sound as cool as a Jake brake, but it acts like a Jake brake. So you don't heat up your pads, and you can watch it you can watch your mileage spin backwards, that you're actually adding miles of range back in when you're going down big hills.
Well, they have that, you know, if you're using a diesel locomotive, they have that equivalent of regenerative brake, dynamic braking.
But what they have, if any of you guys have ever driven a slot cars, and this I'm dating myself back to the 60s and 70s, and when you let off of the controller, there'd be a little winding inside of there, and you could clip those out and off, and you would actually change your electric motor. Any electric motor can turn into a generator if you spin it right. Right. Rather than letting it spin. And it will go and, you know, in that case, you're just basically just heating up a little coil in there. But in the railroad, those big engines, they don't have batteries in them. What they're doing is they have banks and banks of resistive heating in the roof, and big fans that blow this through. So you can see them. If you can ever watch a diesel locomotive going down a hill, if you get the sunlight at the right angle, you could actually see the heat just blowing up out of those engines.
Yeah,
because that's what they're doing.
It's basically a giant electric heater.
It's a massive electric heater. Whereas in this case, it puts it back into the battery. So, and I think, you know, my gut feel is probably about 80% of efficiency in terms of recovered power. Whereas when you're driving down a hill with your RV right now, all of that, that the potential energy that you put into it by gaining altitude turns into heat.
Exactly.
And so you lose it forever with a traditional, you know, internal combustion engine. So again, more interesting things. I just observe everything as I'm driving around, and I'm giggling like a schoolgirl, because I figured some other little gadget. I'm like, well, this is really neat. I should have known this, but there it is. It's cool.
So what is the experience like towing a trailer with an electric vehicle? You said that the performance isn't really...
The performance is actually really quite good. I took my buddy Carl down to Frederick with me so he could fly my drone around and do all that other stuff. And he goes, this thing really kicks. And I said, it does. I mean, I'm blasting up and down the little hills. Now, I'm not going 90 miles an hour. I know in Texas, I've driven across Texas many times. I'm going 80, 85 miles an hour in my Sprinter. And guys are passing me with pickup trucks going, I don't know how fast. So that's not what this is. But, you know, I'm driving on the, you know, the hilly little roads, you know, I'm actually in Route 40, you know, the National Pike, you know, runs right in front of my house in Funkstown. And I'm going 50, 60 miles an hour up and down hills. I'm not feeling like I'm behind, you know, that I'm getting behind. It doesn't feel like I'm doing anything in terms of abusive to it. It just blasts right along. And that's the thing that's really, really interesting in an electric vehicle. When you step on it, it doesn't take like a half a second for the engine to start winding up. And then you can feel the torque converter coming up. And then you can feel the thing start to go. When you hit it, it goes bang like that.
Your ketchup and beer is at the back or front of your refrigerator, depending on where it is.
You want to make sure everything's secured.
Yeah.
But it's something to get used to. It's a fact, you know, when I was both of these things, both the F-150 and the Volkswagen ID4, when I was in town and I would, you know, hit the throttle. I hate to say gas. I hit the gas, hit the throttle. I almost ran right into people in front of me because they weren't getting out of my way fast enough. And I'm in a darn little all electric ID4.
Yeah.
I'm like, whoa, baby. Now, do you want to know what my perfect situation is? My perfect test thing. Since we're talking fun things. So Volkswagen, sometime early next year is going to have something they call the ID.Buzz. The ID Buzz looks like the microbus from the 60s, but it is all wheel drive, autonomous driver. That is, it'll drive itself on the highway. It's got 300 ish mile range, whatever. They've promised to loan me one. If those brave people at Ford and Volkswagen let me do this.
Now, as for towing and RV purposes, what is your feeling about EVs? Are they ready for prime time yet, or is it?
I think it's a little premature. Okay, so for local camping, yes, absolutely. For going across the country, I have not found a single charging station yet that you can actually plug in your tow vehicle while a trailer is attached. You've got to go out someplace, drop the trailer, and then come in and plug in for that 30 or 40 minutes or whatever. I've talked to Electrify in America and a few other guys like that, and they say, now we see that that is a real issue. And some of them, they've got the room, but they didn't block off the space. So there's some guy sitting there with whatever is, you know, conventional internal combustion engine vehicle blocking where I could be just pulling in. And there's a couple of other things that I've just written about what they should do. They really need to have some kind of a basic roof over top of it. They're all sitting out in the middle of a macadam parking lot with the sun beaming in on you.
Yeah, usually way at the back.
Right. And what I would love to see is like a little kiosk that they do for a bus stop, where you've got like a little glass wall thing and you got a roof over top, and maybe you've got a vending machine with cold water in it and free Wi-Fi and a few benches, and you could sit out there. What I find myself doing when I'm waiting for this thing to charge up, I either go into the Walmart and go buy some stuff and sit down and do nothing, but I'm sitting there for 30 minutes waiting for something to happen.
Yeah.
And so if so I'm doing business stuff, I'm on my phone, I got my laptop or whatever, I'm doing stuff. Rather than sitting inside of it, if I had a nice little area that I could sit in, and they got enough electricity there, for heaven's sakes, air condition it if you want. I mean, just do it. Air condition and heat it while you're charging up.
So that's an issue then, is right now your range. Do you know about what, let's say you have a 300 mile trip, right?
Right.
You're going from here to there and campground is 300 miles away.
Right.
How much more time would it take with an EV, thinking you have to at least charge once and disconnect and all of that?
Okay, so what happens is you not only have the power time, the charging time, and you not only have the disconnect time. Many times, for instance, I did a ride the other day. I had to drive 5 miles off the interstate to go to a charging center, and then 5 miles back to a charging center. Now, their gasoline stuff is everywhere. You can drive 500 feet off of an interstate and go get a gas pump. In fact, I would refuse to go drive 5 miles or 7 miles off to go get gasoline, even if I was going to save a couple pennies. But there it was. You're kind of stuck with this. So, you would say, okay, let's say I start with I would not try to go more than probably 100 miles before recharging it, in case you could not find a station, because sometimes they're not working.
Right.
So you would have to have two stops.
Yeah. Your experience, I've seen that there's a fair number of these charging stations where they're either full or.
Right. Exactly right. And sometimes you get, and there'll be like one or two of them out of the four that'll say that they're not operational for whatever reason. I don't know what it is. And you can look at them ahead. One of the things that's really interesting about the Volkswagen, the ID4, if you buy one of those, you as a consumer gets 3 years of free charging at any Electrify America station across the United States. Free gas, basically, for 3 years.
Well, that's because Volkswagen had to pay out for their diesel gate.
There was the diesel gate thing, and they're trying to make everybody feel better and all of that. I don't want to get into the politics of that. But the fact of the matter is, you have 3 years of free charging which feels pretty good. Yeah, now, cool. Yeah, I think it's a great promotional effort on their part. And they make it so that you just walk up to it and you have a phone app and you say, I'm me, and you plug in, and then you can say how much you want to charge it to. And remember, these things only want you to take them to 80% of full charge normally. And then they slow the charging down is what they happen. Yeah, and that last couple of percent to get it to 100% is painfully slow.
So you're at 80% of 300 miles, it's 240 miles, and then you add a trailer. And yeah, you're right, every 100 miles.
Right, 100, yeah, you got to have 20 miles pad on the thing. Yeah. I would never, I mean, I could have made it back from St. Michael's the other day, but I would have been on fumes, as it were. What's the equivalent of electron fumes?
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, I would have been like 10 or 20 miles, and I said, nah, I'm going to see if I can go one of these charging, these local charging things. And
Kaiser Bunny is making rude gestures at you as you pass by at that point.
So and then the other thing you can get, which I'm not experimented with, you can get a converter that'll allow you to plug this into a Tesla, one of the locals, the low power Teslas, not the supercharger ones. Right. You can, in fact, plug that in one of these destination chargers. And Tesla has done a massively good job of just putting these things all over the place, even though there's not that many Teslas. He doesn't have to justify it. You know,
right.
Elon can just do it. So then, there you go.
Can you charge this vehicle up at a campground if you have, you'd have to have a 50 amp service, right?
Well, no, you don't. But it would be painful. So, for instance, the Volkswagen comes with a little 15 amp plug and what we call a level one charger, and it's limited to 1,000 watts. Now, you plug that into any 20 amp outlet, and it'll do like 8 or 9 amperes coming off of it, which converts into 80-ish kind of amperes going into the battery. But the problem with this is, it's all about the kilowatt hours, so the watt hours, right? So it would take roughly 70 hours to recharge that battery plugged into a home outlet. Now, you can get a class 2 charger with a 14-50 plug on it that will charge at, say, 4,000 watts kind of a thing. 40 amps. Yeah. So basically, I've calculated it. You could completely recharge this in about 8 or 10 hours. So overnight.
And what kind of plug? That's a 50 amp plug.
A regular 50 amp RV. So a NEMA 1450 is the standard coin of the realm. So that's the thing that you would have your stove at your house, and your home probably uses that. This is the same thing that you see at your campground. It is not the same 240 only plug that you get for welders. You got to be really careful. If you go look at any of my RV electricity stuff, I've got all kinds of articles why you do not use a Tesla converter plug to plug in your RV into a home welding outlet. You don't do that, or a home Tesla outlet. You don't do that. But what it does, of course, is it does open up the idea of what do campgrounds charge you, because you can use up $10 worth of electricity overnight very easily, depending where they are in the country and you know how much they're paying for per kilowatt hour.
And then friends with campgrounds are very concerned about people bringing in EVs and right. wanting to charge them. So let's say you're pulling a Tesla Model 3 that has a 75 kilowatt battery and
kilowatt hour battery. You were right.
Yeah. And then you want to charge it. There's too many numbers.
Teacher. Let me update. I know something. So Ford just filed a patent that will allow their towed vehicles to actually recharge while you're being towed behind your camper.
That is significant.
I just saw this last night. So they can recharge them a little bit at a time, or you could set them up. They would act like a dynamic braking behind you. So now, rather than just turning on your brakes in your towed vehicle, your towed TOAD, you can do dynamic braking as you're going down hills. Your little Ford, whatever the heck it is, you're towing behind your thing, would be acting like an exhaust brake.
Your Ford Fiesta behind you is slowing down your 30.
Slowing down your big massive class A or whatever. But it makes sense. It all makes sense. And that thing would be fully recharged. And, you know, and I've told him, I said, you know, the 300 mile range is great, but you know, if you've got something that's a towed you know, if you had 100-mile range on it, you'd be happy because you're just kind of driving around. But yeah, all these ones are now going to be 250, 300-mile range. And I sent you a, I'm doing a study on how fast they think that lithium batteries are going to advance. That is how much cheaper they're going to get. And so they're basically saying that the cell's going to drop to about 1/3 of the current costs by the end of this decade. So by 2030, they expect them to cost the lithium batteries to be about 1/3 of their current cost, which implies to me at least double to triple the range. So think about this. If you had an electric vehicle that had a 500 or 600-mile range.
Yeah, 1,500 miles. I mean, even if you cut that in half by pulling a trailer, 750 miles is more than I ever.
You see where I'm going with this. So this, I have high hopes, you know, and I tell, you know, I've told a bunch of my students, I said, look, you know, we as a country are some of the best innovators in the world. We truly are. A lot of other countries copy what we do because we lead the way. We truly do. Even though, you know, we started with hydroelectric power, started with us. It's hard for you to believe, but three-phase power and all that started right up there at Niagara Falls. We led the way with the whole world of how to distribute power.
Well, and speaking of toads, what if you could tow a trailer behind you that could actually charge your electric vehicle?
Teacher. There is a couple of them right now. Yeah, there are. So one company, what is it? Denver Teardrops or something like that. Colorado Teardrop, right. And they make something they call the Boulder. They will be making that and they're working on it. Have you done a review on that one yet?
I did, and I will link to that in the show notes as well.
And so I've talked to them a couple of weeks ago and told them what I was doing. And it basically has a 75 kilowatt hour battery built into that that can be used to recharge your electric towing vehicle.
Yes. Yeah. So that the ID4 has a 75 kilowatt hour battery, right?
Exactly. So right.
It's the same size battery in a teardrop.
Right. And its whole job is to charge the RV or excuse me, the EV that you're doing it. But there's more, because our good buddies at Heimer, Germany, they did an experiment, I think last year, and they looked like a full size, you know, spam can kind of trailer, not a little teardrop. And then I only put 75 kilowatt hour battery in it, put traction motors in the wheels.
Yeah.
So it pushes your trailer. It pushes itself down the highway at 60, 70 miles an hour.
Yeah. And they tried it with an Audi e-tron.
Yeah. Going through the Swiss Alps or something. Yeah, something and like it didn't lose any range. They still had like a 250 mile range driving this thing all over the place. And how they did it, which I think was brilliant. They put a strain gauge. Now they didn't tell me this, but I interpolated this from just reading all the bits and pieces. They put a strain gauge in the trailer hitch itself. And so it was set to always have about 100 pounds of pull. So, and of course, as you're decelerating, it's putting the power back into it. So it can easily match the 250 or 300 mile range of your small vehicle, because it not only has electric brakes, it's got electric motors.
Yeah. So it'll hubs help basically haul itself up the hill.
It'll haul itself up and down the hill. I would love to try one of those. I think that that would be spectacular. And a 75 kilowatt hour battery, you could boondock for days.
Oh,
now that would run heaters.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, without a doubt. And air conditioners.
Yeah. Because mine in the Volkswagen, and I've noted a few of my blogs that I'm working on, it's about 1 kilowatt hour kind of a thing that's for the air conditioner in it. So it would, in theory, run the air conditioner for 75 hours.
Well, and one of the things, you know, the typical Coleman unit that we all have on the roof of our trailers, it stinks. Let's be honest. It's a mediocre device. Truma has a new air conditioning system that's a heat pump.
Teacher. I'm getting one.
I know.
Did I say that?
Yeah.
They just sent me all the paperwork.
Yeah.
So and I will be under NDA for a while, but I will be able to begin experimenting with that. So I saw one when I was out in Indiana the last time and looked at it, and I said, can I get one? And they came out while I was just at the Frog Rally. They had 5 or 6 of their guys, and they came out to my seminars and they said, you're really a popular guy. they are now taking this very seriously about better, higher efficiency air conditioners. I think it's brilliant.
Finally. I mean, we
finally
have our homes, but we're all stuck with that god awful Coleman piece of junk on our
roof. It, you know, again, that's a basic 100-year-old kind of technology, truly, in terms of, you know, how the compressors work. The modern ones, which are the DC inverter compressors, I just personally installed one at my house, a mini split, which is what that is all about, a few months ago. It uses half the power. This thing's a one-ton unit. It uses half the power of my 13.5 kilowatt Dometic, which is standard equipment.
And here is the, when we had the resort, I swapped all the air conditioners in the resort for mini split units.
Yes.
And our average electric bill went from between $900 and $1,400 a month to $300 or $400.
Exactly. And these are also, they're better units. They're more efficient and they're also heat pumps.
Yeah. So we used them in winter.
And they're also quiet. This thing's so quiet, you don't even know it's running. I mean, it's down in the 35 dB range, but quieter than your refrigerator that's running out in the kitchen.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just like, I remember, I'm a sound guy. I measure all of this stuff, but I'm going, I can't hear it running. My wife goes, that's because you have too many years of rock and roll. And I said, well, that part may be true, but guess what? I've got a meter that knows,
So last but not least, I guess we should, since we started kind of on the F-150 power boost, we should kind of end with the F-150 Lightning, which apparently there are 120,000 pre-orders of that thing.
It is really, really interesting. You know, I am now on the, as a member of the media, they've got me first in line. So when one of those is available, I get to play with it. It'll be truly interesting. Again, I am not sold yet on all of the other issues that you have in terms of charging them, but I do know this. I've been promised the F-150 Lightning. Rivian has promised me the R1T as soon as one's available. GMC has promised me the Hummer all electric as soon as one's available. I don't know why I became such a popular guy with all of the motor vehicle manufacturers, but I've told them I'm willing to go experiment with these things and basically break it down into the basic elements of what works and doesn't work. I'm not doing any of this from marketing slicks at all. I'm doing everything from I bring out the test gear, I drag this thing around, I gather data, and then I do some basic number crunching. The F-150 Lightning, they are pushing like crazy. Yeah. It could be really, really great. But again, I think it's ill-advised to think that you're going to hook this up to a big RV and take it all the way across the country. I don't know what the power drop is going to be on it, but it may be, you know, 20 or 30% if you're lucky, if you're really, really lucky with a medium-sized RV.
Yeah.
Who knows?
If it's like any other RV, it's going to be a 40% drop in.
It could very well be, but you know, they could put more batteries in it. I know that the Rivian's supposed to have a 400 mile range. Now here's something that scares me a little bit, even though I intellectually know that it should not scare me. The Rivian is rated to go through a 3-foot deep stream.
Yeah. Well, maybe they just
see all those electric batteries. And I know it's all sealed. I mean, you know how it is. You intellectually know something, but you know, it kind of gives you that squeamish feeling.
Well,
That it's one of those.
About that, somebody is going to go, woohoo, I could go through a stream and do it while the water is flowing, and
Go, well, and get washed down, and then bad things, and all that other. But it was on their website, and I'm going, Now I will tell you what I did last year, and you could talk to my buddy Carl, because we went on a fishing trip, and I backed my little bass boat in there, and I literally forgot to put the drain plug in.
Oh no.
I did. And we're back, and it's just a little bass boat. And Carl goes, did you put the plug in? Oh yeah. Yeah. I got it. You know, I know stuff. I don't forget stuff like that. Just to show you, we all make mistakes. I'm backing it down there, and he goes, pull out from the dock now. And I go, why, Carl? He goes, because the boat is sinking. And I look at it's got 6 or 8 inches of water already in the back of it. Oh, that drain plug. Is that the one you're referring to? Yes. That one.
Oh man. Mike, it's always a pleasure to have you here. We talk electric vehicles, electric trailers. We've just run the gamut. And I think, I think our bottom line is electric vehicles as tow vehicles
Maybe not yet.
Not quite yet, but very, very solid first steps, I think, truly.
Some of the new electric trailers, I mean, a lot of us have already done what these manufacturers are doing. Bunch of solar panels, big batteries,
solar chart converters, on and on. Right. They're basically now making them from scratch. It'll be better integrated. It is because a lot of people are hooking the stuff up and they don't understand really what they're getting into. So yeah, there's a whole pile of these things coming out right now.
Yeah. And so anyway, thank you again for your time. And it's always a pleasure to have you here.
Thanks, Tony. And can you hand me one of those bottles of Perrier that's right over my shoulder?
It's fun. This digital background is, and now notice how I can amputate my arm and I have a flying mic stand.
That's right. Exactly right. Well, this is all fun stuff. Well, Tony, anytime you let me know as I find more stuff, I will we'll do another update.
Sounds great, Mike. Look forward to seeing you again.
Okay. Thanks very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.